actually just want to play a beautiful ballad. This is called I Love You, Forty.
Thank you.
who am I? My name is Melita. I'm from Santiago, Chile. You know where that is? So I'm coming from a musical family. My father is a saxophone player. My grandfather was a saxophone player as well. He was one of the first jazz musicians in Chile in the 50s. And I grew up listening to my father teaching at home since I was, I born listening to him and I'm practicing and doing a lot of lessons at home. So music was always part of my life. You know, one of the first musicians that I heard when I was younger was Charlie Parker. So I grew up thinking that was it, my whole time. And when I was around six, my father was doing a group lesson at home and they needed one more saxophone player to come and do the harmony. They were playing a tune called Brazil. And he gave me my grandfather's alto back then. And I completely fell in love with the instrument. And since then I was always begging my father to teach me. You know, Chile is a really macho country, so it was hard for my father to just decide to teach his daughter how to play saxophone, you know. But after a while, he saw that I was very serious about it. And I would have to say that one of the greatest things that he taught me when I was younger, it wasn't even how to play the saxophone, it was how to practice, you know, and how you wanted to do what you do in the highest level, not halfway, you know. And it's something that it has helped me my whole life, even when I went to Berkeley, you know, or now living in New York, just the love for practicing and doing things right. So the way that he taught me in the beginning was, we always talk a lot about basics, you know, meaning basics. What does it come to your mind when I say basics?
Sound,
rhythm, language, very like details, you know. So we would do long tones and then he would teach me my way around the saxophone, but then he made me transcribe solos by heart. He never made me write it down, and he never made me read them. So he would sit down. I was lucky enough to have a father that would sit down next to me and learn Charlie Parker solos by heart, you know. And back then we used to have cassettes. So I was lucky that I have him, but like we would just go back and then the cassette would stop working. So it was hard. But I remember he would make me transcribe one phrase, and the whole idea of transcribing wasn't just to be able to play the solo, it was to really be able to sound like him, you know. So we will go phrase by phrase, really working on the details, the sound, you know, articulation, like vibrato, how he's playing one note after another one, like actually learning about language, you know. So my father never taught me how to read. I learned when I went to Berkeley. So everything that I learned, you know, intervals or scales or whatever, I was always here, you know. And that is why I feel like the foundation that I have, it was strong, you know, because everything I learned is from heart. And another thing that he did that now I think about it was so helpful, he will teach me about the modes, you know, theory. But instead of telling me what, he told me the major modes, and then I would have to come up with names and analyze every mode on different, you know, minors or augmented scales. So his main focus was always think and learn everything by heart. When I turned 16, I got the chance to meet Danilo Perez. You guys know him? So he invited me to a Panama Jazz Festival, and then I auditioned for Berkeley. I went to Boston, I stayed with Danilo, and auditioned for Berkeley and for New England Conservatory. And I remember the crazy thing for me, well, besides I didn't speak any English, so it was already pretty out, but back then I was studying Jerry Bergonzi's book. Are you familiar with those? But so on my audition for New England, Jerry just appeared there and he started playing amazing drums. And then he sit down on the piano and start playing amazing piano. So that was my first experience in Boston. I won a presidential scholarship there, which means that they pay for all my studies for the 3 or 4 years that I was there. I would say the best experience I had, it wasn't actually Berkeley. It was just being around younger people that wanted to do the same thing that me, you know. Being from Chile, like I never have, I mean, first of all, we don't really have a jazz school to start with. I didn't grow up with any young musicians of my generation, you know, maybe it was a few here and there that I met after. And I didn't have a chance to play, so it was mostly just practicing, like every day, 8, 9 hours, my dad would be with me just practicing, but that was it. So just being around young musicians that have my same mentality and playing jam sessions every night, you know, and then having the discipline from my father to practice. Of course, I party a lot, like we all do, but I was pretty, like my priority to these days is always being like, practice, how can I get better, you know? And I think that because I was like that, I was able to take advantage of the situation when I was at Berkeley. Joe Lovano was one of my main teachers, Greg Goffey and George Garzon, and Hal Crook. I don't know if you guys are familiar with him. And what I love about all those teachers, you know, is that, and one thing that I learned, a good teacher is somebody that can show you possibilities. It's not a teacher that will tell you this is wrong and this is right. You have to do it that way. So I was lucky enough to have teachers that really opened up my mind and said, Melissa, you can go here, you can go there, what you like, you know. So they gave me enough tools to start thinking on my own. You know, I always have teachers that embrace that, think on your own and try to do your best. When I finished Berkeley, I took a bus and I just moved to New York. It's like, bye, never again. And I didn't come back for many years. And the reason why I did that is because in Boston, you start having gigs and it's a small city, so you start feeling comfortable. You know where you are, you have a sense of schedule, because one of the hardest things when you finish school is that you are on your own. Even though it's amazing, but as a musician, professional musician, when I'm free, and I have 24 hours to do whatever I want, you know. So that's one of the tricky things. You have to become very organized with your time and with your goals. Like, and New York really forced me to do that, you know. Like, what am I doing? What am I practicing this? Like, where do I want to go? If not, I feel like New York is such a big city that it's easy to be eaten by what is happening there. So my first few years in New York, I mostly went to jam sessions, to smalls. You all know Spike. Mm-hmm. I Spike for gigs. He never gave me one in the beginning. She was so mean. But what I like about the club and what I like about Spike is that she was like, well, you want to gig? You have to come here every night. You have to pay your duties. And in that sense, New York is very old fashioned. And you have to open your way through, you know. Another thing that it was so helpful, you know, jam sessions are terrible. I think that we all agree on that, no? Or do you have a good time when you play? No? I don't. I never do. Unless it's like very special. So what I love about that is that, this actually happened in Boston. I remember one day I went to a jam session and I felt so vulnerable. I felt so weak because I didn't know the tune. And it was just guys. And I remember going back to school and I had lessons the next day and I was being a crying baby. I was just crying. I was like, I don't, you know, it's hard. And at that moment I told myself, you know, I got here from Chile. I've been playing my whole life. I can just go and cry like a baby, you know. So I made a point that I promised myself that I will go to a jam session. Not just to meet people, but to get over my own fears, you know, and start moving forward. And start letting my ego go and start forgetting about, okay, I have to play this killing because maybe Chris Potter is there and maybe this is just, how can I go there and make music? You know, how can I make people listen to me? How can I make this a musical experience? You know, if I don't know the tune, I just want to stand there and try to hear it. And if not, I come back next day and I hear it, you know. So the jam sessions for me were mostly that, like a confrontation of my own fears and letting go ego. At the same time, I got to meet a lot of people. So all of a sudden I started playing a few gigs here and there. I was mostly a band leader just because I always felt like, well, nobody called me for gigs either. But also I felt like being a band leader will be a good way to know, to get to know who I am and what I like and I don't like. You know, like what music I like, what kind of drummers I like. As a saxophone player, these are things that we don't oftentimes think, you know. It's okay, he's a good drummer, but why do I like him? Why don't I not like him? Why do I like the bass player? Like, just like little things that help you to identify yourself with what direction you want to take. So when I was in New York, I recorded my first album, and then 2012, I applied for the Delonis Monk competition. Are you guys aware with that? So I applied for that competition actually when I was in Berkeley, and at the NGORI, and I decided to apply this again in New York just to see what would happen. And I knew about that competition because my father was there on the semifinal of the year that Joshua Redman won in the beginning, early 90s. So I applied, and I didn't have any expectations. I was like, whatever happens. And then I get the call, I go to the semifinals. And my main preparation for that competition, it wasn't practicing, because I always been like good when it comes to practice and trying to be disciplined, but it was mostly mental, you know. Meaning that for me, winning the competition would mean that if I'm able to step into the stage and just have fun, just be Melissa, whatever is that, not pretend, you know. Also because out of respect for the judges, I have Wayne Shorter, Branford Marsalis, Jimmy Heath, people that already, you know, Jimmy grew up with Coltrane. So I did a lot of thinking of this. I was like, who am I going to fool? You know, they seen everything. So I just better go and do my thing. And the trickiest part of that is that it was just 10 minutes to show everything that you can play. So anyway, I did the semifinals. I got to the finals, and then I won the competition. The best part of the competition was the money, obviously. It was very helpful. But also I got a good record deal. I was able to record my third album. And after that, just opened a lot of doors faster, you know. I wouldn't say that my life changed because of the competition. And I haven't changed. I don't feel different about anything. But it did the process faster, you know, especially even though I don't like to make this difference between genders, but the fact that I'm a woman, I'm South American, kind of like put me in the map faster. But also I feel like I was ready when I wanted, meaning that I had a clear idea of what I wanted to do. When they offered me the record deal, they wanted me to record an album with this old stars band and standards, and I decided that I wanted to do my trio. Because of that, the record label didn't really support me much, but I always believe, and to this day, is that you should always do it for yourself, not for anybody else, you know. And I learned that, I think that is the most valuable lesson that I learned in New York, you know. Like, just do it for yourself. Like, don't worry about what people think. Because that is the only way that you're gonna growing up. You're gonna start growing up. So after that, I think that one of the greatest experiences I have is to be a band leader and be able to play with the same band over and over, you know. So that really gave me the chance to try things, to fail, to play good concerts, you know, to grow, to just play a lot and try different kind of things. And also get to know, be a little bit more mature as a musician, you know, like as a saxophone player, what am I looking into at drums, you know, drummer or bass player or cupping wise, you know. It made me just more aware of myself. Another thing that I wanted to mention before I stop talking about me, so the way that I learned everything that I know and I come to the conclusions I have now and I'm still developing is to transcriptions. So why do you think it's important to transcribe?
To learn the language.
Learn the language? What else? Even more basic. What is important to transcribe somebody?
You sound like that?
Yeah, but? Yeah, but even more basic. So you know what you like or you don't like. You know? Like, for example, people will say, like, Wayne has one of the worst sounds. Like, technically, it's not right. It's out of tune. To me, it's the most beautiful sound, you know? So, sound, you know, learning about sound. Like, I can tell you use this mouth, use this breath, but sound is a concept, it's here, so you learn it through transcription. And you learn about what you like as a musician. You know, I believe that in our generation, we have the thing where we want to be innovative and want to play like ourselves. But through all the years of transcribing, I can hear how everyone that is there came because of a reason, you know. So for example, let's say somebody like Mark Turner, which to me is one of the most innovative tenor players of our generation. Where is he coming from? Okay, but have you heard him when he was younger too? Early Coltrane. Brecker, where is Brecker coming from? Yeah, it's like all copies from Joey Anderson. Sonny Rollins.
Lester Young.
Coleman Hawkins. Like it's clear, you know. And so this is very basic things that we as a musician, either if we want to play this kind of music or salsa or whatever it is, then we need to be informed of our instrument, you know. So as a saxophone player, I did the homework of checking out my history, where I'm coming from, you know, even if it's all whatever. And one of the things I found out was that every saxophone player that I love was coming from somewhere. It's an history, you know. So for my observation as well, I feel like when you transcribe deeply one person and then you transcribe another one and another one, it's kind of like you have a big soup, you know, and you put potatoes, carrots, and as you get older, you decide what kind of condiments, what kind of veggies, you know. And you start thinking about directions because you have a clear idea of what you want or where you want to go. Does that make sense? And as important, well, so my process of transcribing is usually a process of 2-3 years where I have a deep relationship with that person. Why so long? Because I feel like in order to get into somebody's mind, because I'm not trying just to play the notes, I'm trying to figure out what is he thinking about, you know, like his concept. For me, it's usually like a process of like eating information, like memorizing one solo, other solo, other solo, other solo. Of course, with all the knowledge of harmony, you know, not meaning that I'm analyzing it, but I know about, you know, I know my instrument, I know about harmony. So as I'm hearing, I'm thinking at the same time. And usually, and I promise you, this is like this, like after a year of transcribing the same person, like you just start hearing. You know what I mean? And it's no way back. It's just like, it's inside of you. But in order to get to that point, you have to commit to something, to do it right, to master it. And then it gets to a point where you're like, okay, I sound exactly like Mark. That is it. Now it's detox. And it's years to get rid of that. But with all the transcriptions that you do or whatever you're studying or influence, as you start growing and playing more and always thinking about how can you move forward, you start finding where you want to go. And maybe it's not that direction, but it starts changing, you know. And everything who I am right now and people that I really admire, I hear that, you know. It's a deep understanding of the history and of the basics. Being able to play a blues, just knowing standards, even though you may not want to do that, that is completely fine. But you know where you're coming from and you're going there because of a conclusion. You know, not because you're skipping something. And I believe that is what makes Mark or Kerry Rosenwilken or Steve Lehman or whoever or Matt Coleman, that is why they're so strong with what they have to say. You know, it's an investigation, it's a foundation and investigation together. Yeah, so that is my whole story. Questions? Questions?
What do you think of when you choose a band, or what are the priorities that you look for when you choose a rhythm section?
First, I want nice people. I don't want people that are just like giving headaches, you know, to start with, because when you're on tour, like you, yeah, 1 week everyone is happy, 2 weeks, but third week it gets tricky, you know. It's always like that. You know, it doesn't matter how good of a friend you are. So it's important to have somebody that is cool and respectful with spaces, you know. I want somebody that is on top of their shit.
Sorry, on top of?
On top of their shit. You know, like meaning if somebody calls me for a gig, I'm gonna go there and memorize the music. It doesn't matter if it's a brand gig or anything, because I always wanna do the best I can. And that's what I expect from my musicians as well, you know. I'm looking for somebody that is stronger musically than me, so I can learn from that. You know, somebody that is gonna not just go in my direction, somebody that is gonna challenge me and make me think, and is not afraid of that at the same time, you know. I'm looking for somebody that is listening, you know, for somebody that, as I said, like, is not afraid of taking risks, you know. So if I'm on a tour for 2 weeks, I want somebody that will just count off the tunes lower, just like find ways to make it fun for us every week, you know, creative. And it's mostly that, like, it's not just the level being a great musician, it's somebody that can hear, the bigger picture of what is going on. More questions?
How do you think about taking a breath?
Taking a breath? What do you mean?
When?
Silent.
Yeah, like when you're playing, when you have to like breathe in air. How do you?
So now that you're talking to me and you pause, do you think that I'm gonna breathe right now and then keep talking? You know what I mean? Like when you're talking, like you have to breathe. It's natural.
Yeah.
So that's the same thing that I think when I'm playing the set. You know what I mean? Just like I'm talking and I'm taking time to think, or I'm taking time to, yeah, just to say my speech. That's one of the samples I was talking about, patience. You know, patience. And as a horn player, for us, it's a little bit easy because we need to breathe, you know, like piano players don't need to breathe, you know. So by nature, we need to stop at some point and breathe, you know. And listening a lot, you know, question answer or answer questions, whatever it is, you know. So if I'm not hearing something, or if I don't know what to play, I will just let them play and let the music breathe and tell me what it means, you know. So I think it's mostly awareness. It's mostly that, just awareness.
How do you memorize changes, whether it's standards or some original modern pieces?
So I look at it the same as transcribing. Do you guys know the program Transcribe?
Mm-hmm.
Or Making a Slowdown? So usually when I have to memorize like a new tune, I will always start by the melody. And it's the same when I have to memorize a standard or whatever, melody first. Mm-hmm. Melody comes. Or anything. And then usually, you know, we all have iPhones these days, so it's really easy to make like a kind of aversal for us with some new music, you know. So I will write down the harmony on my iReal book and make a little demo for myself. But at the same time, I will try to go to original recording and try to listen what voicings is the piano player playing. Because sometimes they're playing certain voicings that make the whole color of the solo sound different, you know. So that, as a saxophone player, I do that a lot. I go to piano players and try to see like how they're thinking. And then repetition, that's how you memorize anything. If you say a phrase 100 times, you won't forget it. No? I hope not. I won't. So it's repetition, you know? It's just the same when it comes to transcriptions. Like I have memorized songs of 30 minutes. But it's because I do it every day slow, and I repeat it over and over and over and over. And then I add another phrase, and I relearn two, and then over and over and over and over, and then another one and over. So the hard thing actually is not the memorizing part. The hard thing is to sit down and do it.
Yeah.
No?
Do you have a specific way of, maybe if you have a long solo, that you cut it in certain pieces, or? To memorize them, to or like organize, to practice the certain solos.
Mm-hmm. No, I will usually spend like an hour or 2 hours, and then I will go phrase by phrase.
Mm-hmm.
So whatever I think I can take, I will just memorize that. and then memorize the next thing. Usually how it goes for me is that I memorize something, and then when I memorize the next phrase, I forget the first one. Very, very natural. So then I have to kind of relearn both together. And then I play very slow and then faster, faster. Or maybe I will try to play even a little bit faster than the actual recording.
Mm.
And next day I go back and I replay all that slow and then fast, and then I add something, you know. So it's very like, just little by little bit,
yeah,
you know. And the reason why I can remember solos, I don't remember all the solos that I have transcribed, but I can remember solos from years ago because I transcribed it like that.
Mm.
You know, I'm like mostly working my brain. I'm working memorizing. Like, I know that we all say, and it's funny actually, I had a student that she's like 6 years old and she's like, oh, I have bad memory. You know, so we all think that we have bad memory, but it's not, you know, it's how you do it.
Mm.
How you internalize information. And there is it.
And do you, if you start transcribing, you stick with one certain person for that period of time?
Yeah.
Okay.
So I'm not saying this is the right way to do it, but what works for me and with anything that I do is that I have to stay with something for a long time, because that way it's never going to go away. You know what I mean? So like with Mark, I remember transcribing like for 3 years. And then now I can't even see him. Like, I don't even go to see him to concerts, just say hi. You know, I don't hear more cure because it was so deep inside of me, you know. But it was like that because I heard him so much. I committed myself to that. But, you know, for some other people, maybe it's good to transcribe to people, you know. So that's what I'm saying. Like, it's important to know what worked for you. You know, what works and what doesn't work. Yes.
I guess the more and more your career goes on and then you go on to work and stuff, you get less time for practicing. So I guess you have to come up with some schemes to make your practices more efficient or figure out where to get time for your practice and how to cope with it.
Yeah, so I don't know, I'm a little bit crazy. For me, like, practicing is always a priority. You know, it's always a priority. So you will probably see me at the school at 8 a.m. and just trying to go a good hour, 2 hours, you know, just the instrument. But what it always comes to practice basics. That's what matters the most. Because out of all the musicians I love, everyone has a sound, ideas, and a strong rhythm. So those are the basics that I work, you know. And of course, it changed, you know, like how I practice it or how I approach it. The way that I do long tones is not the same that I did 10 years ago. Now maybe it has more meaning, you know. I'm looking for something and I'm just thinking that what is that I can't find out, you know. So I will always do like priority long tones, an hour or 30 minutes, you know. Let's say I just have an hour. And then I will do some technique. And then I always try to learn a solo just because it's fun for me, you know. So I kind of do a solo a week and then just forget. Just to, you know, every time, because that's the other thing, like, I oftentimes don't feel like practicing. I don't know how it's for you guys. Do you wake up in the morning, you're like, yes, let's do it? No? Okay, it's very rare for me to be like, yes, you know. And so I have to figure out a way to make myself into it, you know. And for me, transcribing is fun. Why? Because I can see the process clearly. You know, I can see, okay, this is the solo I want to transcribe. I learned the first phrase, and at the end of the week, I know a whole solo. I see the process. While practicing long tones or learning something, like, it's not that clear. It's just like slow and boring, you know. So I always try to balance like practicing with something that I'm like super passionate about it, and something that actually I really have to practice and work. But I think that the main thing, in order to, you know, when you have less time or whatever, is practicing comes first to me. It always does. I have here, you know, I took lessons with George Coleman. He said, wait until you're older, it will change, you know. But you know, if I will have like an hour to rest, I will just try to practice. Why? Because also I feel like having the opportunity to travel so much and play all the time, if I practice, I can really take advantage of that. you know, even if I'm practicing something new or not new, I feel like I can move forward a little bit, you know, and that's what I want, that's what I care the most, like, how can I get better, just a little bit every day, you know, so that's why practicing comes a priority always. And you just have to organize, you know, like, okay, tomorrow I wake up at this time, I have this hour, okay. But, you know, not everyone is like that, so again, it's whatever works for you. Questions?
When do you know that you own a song? When it goes connected to your heart?
You know it.
Yeah.
You know? No, you know, like, it's, you just know it. You know, you can be drunk, you can be in any state, you have it. It doesn't matter. Nobody can take it away. The same when it comes to transcribing, you know? Like, you get to a point where you're like, okay, I got it. It's enough. Let me move on. You know? So it's usually when it's just part of you, you know, it's part of your being. Like that happened with Mark, that happened to me, you know, it got to a point where I didn't have to analyze, I just hear what he's doing and I know it's enough. I know I have it. And then I move forward. But yeah, it's all on you. That's why I'm saying that it's, you know, practicing, going to a school is one thing, but then when you're on your own, it's hard. Because it's your own judgment on what you're doing, you know, and when it's enough, or when to practice that, or when you got it done. But believe me, you once you do it and you own it, you will feel it. More questions?
What do you expect from somebody that's come to you, or like the interaction, and like you ready to have somebody that's laying down the basis and make it background? Or making a conversation?
I want somebody that is giving me something. You know? I don't want to just go and like throw up ideas. Like I want to talk. I want to, even if that talk means just to play three notes, you know? I like people that think, you know? So it's not just about being a good musician. It's people that are thinking, that is looking for the meaning, you know, even if you're just playing a simple blues, like, how can you make it yours, you know? Even if it sounds like somebody else, doesn't matter, but like, you know, you feel that when you play it. More comments? Questions?
Who do you listen to the most nowadays? Before it was my turn, what's now?
Oh, now?
Maybe several players.
I'm really into Lionel Hampton right now. And I'm thinking, like, just out of fun, you know, like, the language of the vibraphone is so different than the saxophone, that I'm just like, you know, I'm just trying to look for something that will help me to kind of switch off things, you know. And so, yeah, I'm mainly just, I'm transcribing one of his songs, and that is it, you know. I usually, you know, of course I hear, I mean, if you want to ask me about what other kind of music I hear, I love Argentinian folklore. It's a band called Acacia Gatillo, Spinetta, or I love Hermeto Pascual, you know. But talking about jazz, one of the things that I've been doing is going back and really knowing my, trying to check out my history as a musician, you know. Our generation, maybe it's not for like that for you guys, but we suffer from having too much available for us, you know? Meaning that these days you check an album and you don't even know who is on the album. I'm the first one to blame, you know? I don't, and the information is not there, you know? So we're used to just like download all those things on Apple Music or Spotify and have 100 CDs, and we haven't actually really checked anything deeply, you know? So that's one of the things I'm doing. I'm just deleted my Apple Music account and just have 5 CDs and choose what I want to listen to. And like go and listen to it a few times so I can make an idea and then do the other thing, you know. So lately as a saxophone player, I'm checking out Eddie Locke the Dailies with Johnny Griffin, which are albums that I never really put much attention. Questions, comments?
Maybe you want to play a bit more?
Do you want me to show you the examples of transcriptions?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, so you have an idea of what I'm talking about.
So I will, I'm not sure I have all this on my computer, but what I intend to show you is three solos. Do you guys know Don Byas?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So one is by Don Byas, another one is by Sonny Rollins, and another one is by Chris Potter. I will show you something by Mark, but I really, not on my computer. Okay, so are you guys familiar? You said you're familiar with Don Byas? Not everyone said yes. No? Okay, so if I were you, I would write it down. Don Byas, he's a saxophone player from the 30s and 40s. He's kind of like before the bebop era. And what is so hip about him is that he's really hip into harmony, like crazy substitutions for the period of time that he was playing that. And a lot of his language reminds me of what is happening these days, you know, Mark Conner. And so this is a live concert that happened in a hall in New York in 1945 with Slam Stewart. You guys familiar with Slam Stewart? Okay, amazing bass player. So this is a duo concert, and this is back home in Indiana.
Thank you. Thank you.
Ken. Question.
Yes.
Like, do you choose, like, when you're studying, so you choose one of these and
sorry, can you talk louder, please?
Yeah, and how do you choose, like, after things, so do you listen before to the discography or
so, you know, like, in the beginning, I always had my father that was like, transcribe this, you know. But I believe if you guys are new into transcription, you know, practicing is so personal to start with. So choose something that you're falling in love for real. You know, like, doesn't matter even if it's Kenny G, even though I don't like Kenny G, but you know, like, something that will really, like, make you want to do it, right? You know, because it's not easy to start just practicing, so you have to do something that's just gonna be like, wow, I want it so bad, you know. And that is the feeling that I have with every solo I had. Like, I mean, this solo is like 30 minutes long. I finished it. I don't remember the whole thing. I transcribed it a long time ago, but I was so upset with the idea of, like, no, I want to do it, you know. So it needs to be something that just drives me crazy.
Yeah.
Like, it's like a good challenge, like good kind of challenge, you know.
So you
first and then you.
So you had a long time with Potter as well, exclusive.
Yeah, with Chris Potter, not that long.
Okay.
Not that long. I check him out a little bit, you know, like, I would say, like, my three main influence is Don Byas, Sonny Rollins, and Mark. I'm coming from those guys. And then Breaker, that I did, like, when I was really young. I'm sure all saxophone players have a Breaker affair. I don't know. I did this because my father is from that generation, you know, so we transcribe all the Breaker solos, you know. So a lot of what I have that it may sound a little bit like Chris is actually coming from Mike Breaker. But the reason why I transcribed this specific solo, it was because, like, as I'm growing as a musician, I'm always wondering, like, what do I like and I don't like? What am I missing? You know. And I'm very self-critic of myself, but in a very positive way, you know. So I was wondering, like, I wanted to learn how to create tension, you know, how to manage energy when I'm playing. It's always been something hard for me because I feel like when the rhythm section goes crazy, I don't even know what to do anymore, you know. And to me, Chris Potter is one of the masters of that, you know, like reacting with rhythm section. So when I transcribed this solo, I was transcribing the notes, but I was mostly trying to figure out, like, what is he doing that create that kind of energy? Why, you know? And then oftentimes, like, every time that I ask myself something like, how do I do this or how do I do this, I usually go to somebody that does it really well. And then I just get the idea from there, you know. So one of the things I discovered with Chris Potter is drums and Chris. It's a conversation, you know. So he creates tension with rhythm. You know, that is how he created, you know. And it's a conversation between him and the drummer. So it took me a whole solo to, like, kind of understand that, you know. Even though I kind of knew it, but, like, if I transcribe it and if I listen to it, you know. Because I do a thing, when we're transcribing, oftentimes, and it's good to be like that, but you concentrate just on the actual solo and the player. But then, what is the rhythm section doing? It can tell you a lot, you know. So that is why I start transcribing this solo and one more of Chris Potter.
As a very little parent, do you transcribe mistakes as well?
Well, I transcribe everything. Mm. So that's the other thing. Like, you know, I remember one time I did the whole Unlost Dream album, Train. When I was young and patient and I didn't have a boyfriend or anything going on in my life. And it took me a long time, but I learned something very important, that when you transcribe, a lot of time it comes to interpretation as well. Because, you know, unless it's somebody like, I think that Breaker and Mark are the only two people that I transcribe, and it never be like, wait, what is this? It's perfect. It's not even funny, you know. It's basically perfect. But, like, a lot of Chris Potter or, you know, Coltrane or any other player, there are parts where you're like, oh, I don't know what it is. So then it comes to your own interpretation, you know, it may be a mistake or not, but just trying to figure out like what he was trying to say or what are you hearing. So yes, I transcribe everything and try to interpret it.
So when you actually play it, you play the version that in your head is supposed to be what he wanted to get.
What I think it fits the best.
Okay.
You know?
Yeah.
Like it may be right, it may not, like whatever, I think that's the closest thing that I can get, you know?
Yeah, so, well, it's kind of related. Like when you're transcribing, so how much do you take like a concept and work around it rather than like just doing the whole solo? Like, you do that? Like take this phrase, as he's using this, and think what he's
yeah.
using harmonically, and then
yeah.
take it and transpose it, or how do you, and how do you approach that?
Yeah, so again, this is my way of doing it. And also it comes because I'm a little bit lazy, so I don't like to write solos down. Like I just wanna spend time with this, you know. So how like usually, and it usually works better for me instead of, unless it's something that I'm like, wow, this is, I need to know what it is, you know. But usually after transcribing one solo, just memorizing it, like perfect, like I just play like as close as possible. After transcribing like 10, 20 solos, I can hear it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So I don't even know, actually, I wouldn't even able to tell you like what Mark is doing, but like I hear it, you know? And that's the other thing, like after you transcribe so much, you develop really good ears, you know? So you hear it and then you are able to play it and then you are able to sing something of the concept and then play it at the same time, you know?
Okay.
So for some people, it would work better to sit down and analyze it, and that is completely fine.
But also not writing, just like hearing and trying to figure out what he's doing.
I would say that is even better, you know? But if you need to write it, that is good too,
mm-hmm.
you know? But in my experience, like when I force myself to memorize everything, I just never forget about it, you know? It's like, it's really deep inside, you know? But it takes, it's hard because it's a lot of mental work, you know? And that is the way also that I approach, for example, when I'm practicing technique, like I never practice something that is just fingers, like something that I'm thinking, like I have to, okay, this is the nine of these, like, it's this, you know? Because I see it, like I just don't forget. But when I learn something or I write it down, you know, maybe if I lose the piece of paper, I never go that deep into it.
Mm-hmm.
So then how
did you study the Bergonzi book?
No, well, the Bergonzi book is different because it's a book, you know, like it's something that's already written. And the reason why I practice that, because that book, the special book, Pentatonics and Hexatonics,
mm-hmm.
is amazing for harmony. But with that being said, like in that book, he tells you to do a lot of exercise and they're not written down. So that book also puts you to think, you know, he's just giving you formulas like 1, 6, 7, whatever it is. And then you have to think and do it, you know? So I just really think that like when you learn something by memory, like there's no way, even if you're super drunk in like growing up, aside, like you will still be able to sing this all, you know? You just with you. Questions? Comments?
What would be, in your imagination, a good way of musicianship or learning process without any transcribing?
Oof, I don't know.
People that you know that don't transcribe at all but amaze you or are interesting musicians for you.
Mm-hmm. I don't really know anybody that haven't gone through that process, you know. I'm sure there are people, you know, and I'm not saying that you have to transcribe in order to do that, but, you know, after I won that competition, I decided that I wanted to take lessons with all my favorite saxophone players, you know, and I just talked to them about the process. And everyone went through this phase, everyone, you know, just like imitating, transcribing something, like just getting an idea of where they wanted to come from, you know? But again, like I'm not saying that's what you have to do, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But to me, it seems like, yeah, all the people that, even the freer players, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Somebody like Ornette, like you hear the language, you just hear the basics very strong,
you know. And if anything, like I would say that transcribing is not just to sound like somebody, I mean, just to play the same lines, but also to learn about sound, you know, sound in your instrument, which is something that we don't, like, sound is not just being in tune and like playing louder, and sound is a concept, you know? So that's why I find transcribing important too, you know, because you can teach a concept. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So when you try and transcribe Lionel Hampton, how do you think about sound then? Because you're different instruments.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you think then?
I just try to play as similar as possible, you know? Just as similar as I can. And also there are some octave difference, you know, with the saxophone. So that's where interpretation comes, like adjustment, like whatever I think that's the closest, I do it, you know?
Have you just read piano players?
Yeah, I did some Herbie solos. But, you know, I can't do with the harmony, you know? But it's mostly, I mean, right now, like mostly every time I transcribe is to steal some information, you know? I'm just like, that is what it is, you know. If I wonder, and I'm mostly not transcribing saxophone players because I feel like I did my duty with that, and I just want to get something a little bit different, you know, and see how I can combine it. But yeah, when it's piano player, I just transcribe the lines. That is mostly. I did a lot of Kurt Rosenwilken's solos too.
Oh.
It's just so challenging because the saxophone goes to the very high of the horn, you know, so it becomes tricky, but it's fun, it's nice. And it's also, it's hard because it's a completely different language. I mean, it's the same, but it's different approach, you know. Even when I transcribe alto players, it's different language.
How do you train your rhythmical skills?
So, talking about rhythm, this is something that I always wonder, like how can you practice rhythm? And one thing that I realized is that when I wanted to learn more about rhythm, I was more worried about like the actual, like, you know, being very rhythmic, but I didn't have the very basic thing, you know, just it's like quarter notes, eight notes, basic, you know, and I didn't have a sense of the big one, you know, so that is why I wasn't feeling free when I was improvising. You know, because I wasn't feeling like one, you know. And it took me a minute to realize that, like, whatever happens, if you have a sense of the big one, it's fine. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And in order to have a sense of the big one, I have to be able to play really slow, really, like painfully slow, and still feel it good, like, I don't get nervous either. You know, but I feel the big one. So to me, a good way to practice rhythm is, first of all, taking care of that. Like being able to play a major scale with the metronome on 30. And then, another thing, like when you go, same thing, like you wonder how you play fast, how you play so fast, the big one, that is the whole. So when you go to recordings of, you know, Sonny or whoever, and you hear him playing something super fast, it's a lot of mysterious things happening in the middle, but it's always a big one, and that makes everything come alive, you know. So I would say that, go back to the basics, you know. Another thing that is great is just play with drummers, you know. Because one thing that happened to me when I wanted to become more deep into rhythms, it was that the first thing that was getting in the way was that I was afraid to turn around. I was afraid to embarrass myself, you know, to get lost. As I got rid of that fear, I start playing, I play trio, I turn around, it was crazy. But I felt confident to do it, you know, so I start trusting. And then another thing that I have to start thinking is that I have to start trusting my drummer, you know. So it's not such a thing as like, okay, this is the one, this is the A, like it can be anywhere, you know. But as long we're all in one same space, it makes sense. So I went back and listened a lot of like 90, you know, Miles albums where they play with the quintet, where it seems just like crazy. Everyone is, you know, I'm like, wow, how they keep the form? They don't keep the form. You know, they, but like they are so in one channel. You know, everyone is together. Anything rhythmic that happens, everyone is together. You know, same with Chris, Chris solo. I have, like, actually, I have analyzed some parts where it's rhythmically very complicated. And sometimes there are some funky beats here and there, you know, but they come together. It's the same when you wonder, like, how can you play out? You know, you can play out of over anything, but as long where you know where to resolve, that's what is going to make it make sense. So that's what I'm talking about. That's when I say it's important to know the basics, because that is the only way that you're gonna become free when you wanna talk. No?
At the end, how about that? And next steps, what were your next steps in improving? Like, or neither, or
mm-hmm.
you're not teaching
something? I am. I start taking some very basic exercise I always do, and I start doing it in a group of seven. And we just put it in. You all know arpeggios, no? Major. Basic. So I will practice it like this. So you can start feeling, you know, you can start feeling how the one change, you know. Same, you know, I will, are you a saxophone player?
Yeah.
Okay. Same when it comes to the altissimos on the horn, you know. I get that question that asked often, how do you work on altissimo? It's the same, like just incorporate it to your practice with very basic things. Mm. You know, you play your major scales, you play at the high, at, until the high B. You want to practice group of seven, just group. Just do the scaling group of, you know, mark every seven notes or four or three notes, you know? But it's always about that. Just take it to the basics. And then when you're learning standards on the, I mean, these days it's so easy for us. On the IRL book, you can put any key, any meter you want. Mm-hmm. So don't be afraid to just feel it super, you know, bam, 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 bam. We, of course, want to be free of that. At the moment of playing on seven, you know. But you have to feel it like that in the beginning in order to feel free with the other part. Yeah. Does that make sense?
Yeah. One other thing, I've heard a lot of your live recording, which is live show, and when you take solo, there's loads of like one motif being developed for a good chunk of time. In a good way. How do you deal with that, or how do you, you know, make that such level that it works every time, or you know how to use one of people to know that money.
Yeah. Well, a lot of times, I mean, sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work, but to me, like, I don't see the point to be playing with the same band and travel all around and do so much practice to play the same shit every day. You know what I mean? So a lot of time, like, you know, it's normal, I don't feel inspired or whatever. And I always look for something that will help me to just go somewhere, you know. And sometimes it goes somewhere, sometimes it doesn't, you know. But I try to put like a lot of thought about like how can I say a speech, you know, how can I say a story, you know. And through developing what motive is, sometimes it really helps me to like, okay, let me decide that they're like, okay, we all that way. And maybe sometime I find something surprising. Maybe it's just no point, you know. But it's coming out of that, like just trying to challenge myself and like think, you know, not just let the fingers play, like think. and make people react. But you know, Sonny is the master of that. Have you guys heard Live in London, Volume 1 and 2? No? So for some reason, it's on YouTube. You can buy it on iTunes for some reason. And to me, that's one of the most clearest examples of how you develop, you know, a motif and how you play with the rhythm section. So if you're guys wondering how you react, that album is, I mean, it's actually a track called Nadi from Monk, from Lonely's Monk. And everything I'm talking about is very clear. Interaction, like how they're talking with each other. Mm-hmm. It's time. One more question, you guys are cool?
Oh shit.
Okay, thank you so much, guys.
Thank you. Let's subscribe.